Okay, so you've been using GarageBand for a while and you've played around with the amp designer and the pedal board and you've realized that, man, there is a wealth of different amp emulations here. You can move the microphone where you want on the speaker. You can choose between different microphones, not to mention all of the pedals you have access to on the pedal board. So you can create so many different chains. Like, I have a very simple setup here. I have a clean sound, a crunch sound, a distorted kind of sound. And maybe you've been wondering, hey, why do I need to bring all my actual gear on gigs? Maybe I could just bring this very small laptop and maybe use a MIDI controller like this one to just, you know, use two foot switches to scroll through my presets. And then you got all excited, you know, hey, I'm gonna make this work. This is gonna be great. Only to find out that GarageBand does not have MIDI learn. Like most other DAWs, you can just right click and then there is a learn option and then you press your actual physical knob on your controller and boom, the assignment is made and you're good to go, but not so on GarageBand. And it makes sense because this is just a, you know, slimmed down version of Logic. So what Apple wants is for you to fall in love with the sounds and then encounter the workflow limitations like this one and fork over the money to get Logic. The good news I want to share with you today is that there is actually a workaround and it just involves downloading a free utility, which, by the way, you don't even need to install it. Like, it's not one of those obtrusive pieces of software that will install files in hidden folders and it's going to be a pain in the ass to uninstall. This one, you just download it, you put it wherever you want to put it, double click on it, and it's good to go. And it's the one we have down here, and I'm going to open it. It's called MidiPipe by Subtlesoft, and I'm going to leave the link to it in the description box. And this, basically, you can think of it as like something that comes in between your physical controller and your DAW, in this case GarageBand. So it's an extra step and it's going to change the MIDI messages you send into your computer before they reach GarageBand. And right here on the left hand pane you have all these possible different modules. It makes sense to start with MIDI in, right? So I'm going to click on MIDI in and drag it onto my actual pipe I'm creating here, and I'm going to select my blue board, which is, you know, the controller I have. You're going to want to select the one you own, and then we might as well put an output in there as well while we are at it. And in this case I think it's best to just create a virtual output. It's not going to make much of a difference because GarageBand doesn't really have a very advanced MIDI management system, so whatever you send it will just receive. So you could also set this to the IAC driver, which is Apple's internal MIDI driver. Just be sure not to use your actual physical piece of hardware, because otherwise you would be sending MIDI into your laptop, into MIDIPipe, and then back into your controller as opposed to GarageBand. So I'm just gonna select MIDIPipe output, and then in between those two you can drag a number of modules. And as you can see, you have stuff like channel filter, keyboard split, you know, a bunch of very useful things, but we only need two for this scenario right here. And actually we only really need one. The second one we just need to start and then we can delete it. And it's the AList module. And this one is gonna save all the MIDI messages you are sending into your laptop. So to give you an example, I'm just gonna press on this button right here. I'm gonna keep it pressed. And as I press, as you can see, it sent a message and it's continuous. I'm keeping this pressed, by the way. It's continuous controller 21, as you can see here. And then there's the actual MIDI data. 21 is the controller, 127 is the value, and the first number, I don't know what it is, but it's there. And if I release this, it sends the exact same message, but with a value of 0. And this is like an on-off switch. You press it, you keep it pressed, it's on, and then you release it, and it sends an off message. We can ignore the release message, right? Right? We don't need to care about that. Well, we're at it. So I don't know if you can see this, but next to the B button I just pressed, there is a downwards arrow. So I want this to be what allows me to scroll downwards through my preset list. And next to the A button here, there's an upwards pointing arrow. So that's going to be the foot switch to move upwards in my preset list. So I'm going to press this as well. As you can see, the message it sent is almost identical. It's just the continuous control number 20. But that's the only difference. And in fact, I remember those numbers, so I can just go ahead and delete the A-list and directly move on to the AppleScript Trigger. That's the only module we're ever gonna need here. Now, don't be confused by this. Me personally, I don't know jack shit about AppleScript, but what it does is it allows us to trigger certain actions, like, for instance, a key press or whatever, selecting a certain window. Whatever actions you can perform on your laptop, you can automate with this. And MIDIPipe allows you to to associate your AppleScript to MIDI messages. So why is that useful to us? Well, the fact that GarageBand does not have a MIDI learn function doesn't mean that it doesn't have shortcuts. And in fact, there are two shortcuts which are very important for what we're doing here. And the first one is the right pointing square bracket. Watch what happens if I press it. As you can see, it scrolls through my presets downwards. And the left pointing square bracket, you guessed it, scrolls through my presets upwards. So that's the shortcut we want to use, and that's why we need AppleScript. And this utility, we want MIDIPipe to say whenever continuous control number 21 is received and whenever MIDI CC 20 is received, please trigger the following script. And before we even go into the script, which is again super easy, I just want to tell you about the actions we need to trigger. So the first thing is we want to bring GarageBand to the forefront, because if I just open my calendar app and press any one of the square bracket keys, it's not influencing GarageBand anymore because it's not in the forefront. So that's the first action we do want to trigger. The second action, of course, is the bracket keystroke, okay? So just so we have a framework, let's get right into the nitty-gritty. So as you can see, as you drag the AppleScript trigger module into your pipe, it has a default kind of configuration, which is very useful because it has a lot of the code, I guess this is code, right? That we actually need to use. We just need to tweak it to our needs. So the first line says on run me message, and what that means is that whenever a certain message is received, all of the code that comes in the following lines should be applied. Then we can define what exactly that message is. It's going to be our MIDI messages, obviously, but for now we can leave that there. So once the message is received on run me message, tell application finder, no, we want to tell application GarageBand activate, which means come to the front. And then we want to input an end tell, because this was the first message we had here, right? Tell GarageBand come to the forefront. Okay, that was the first message. Then the next line, if item one of message equals item two equals blah blah, that's our actual MIDI message. And that is why we needed the AList module before, because now we know the numbers we want to put in here. And I think the first one was 176. The second one was either 20 or 21. Let's start with 21 actually. And then this is beautiful to item 3 of message is larger than 0. Remember how my controller would send a certain message when I press the button and a separate message when I release it, which we want to ignore. We just want one message, right? That's our way of doing that. The message with a value of 0 that we send by releasing the button is going to be ignored. So that's beautiful. So if that is the MIDI message we received, then it says here say MIDIPipe. That's not what we want. We want to then tell, with maybe two L's, application system events. And system events are things like you pressing a key, you clicking on your trackpad. Those are system events. So of course, clicking, or rather pressing our square bracket key is a system event. And here we need to input key code 30. Now every key on your keyboard has a code associated to it. And code 30, you guessed it, is the right pointing square bracket. Good, so that is done, end tell. And then by the same token, you know, I can just copy this and paste it instead of the default we had here, and just change the message value to 20 and the key code to 33. 33 being the left pointing square bracket, and 20 being, of course, the message I have associated to my upwards pointing arrow button here. And then the last line is going to be and run me, because we started with a run me message. Now it says up here not compiled. We need to save this and reopen it for it to actually be effective. So let's just save it to the desktop and just, okay, my pipe, whatever, save. Now we can open it again by pressing Command O, and if we click on our Apple trigger, it contains errors. Beautiful. That means there's something here that isn't correct. So we misspell something probably. And there it is. As you can see, I have application spelled out with three P's here. So let's remove that. And we're gonna need to Command S again to save this, Command O to open it again. And now it says compile. So now we're good to go. So I have my last preset selected, as you can see here in the background. So I'm gonna press A to move upwards and move to the crunch preset. So here goes. As you can see, it brought GarageBand to the forefront. MIDIPipe is now in the background, we can see it. And then it just pressed on the left pointing square bracket. And so GarageBand interpreted that as move upwards in the presets. And if I press B, it moves downwards. And of course, that applies to whatever preset bank you have. If I created a new project by pressing Command N, let's create a software instrument project. Suppose you're a keyboard player, right? And you want to use GarageBand sounds. Let's press B. And as you can see, it's scrolling down through these presets. And what's even cooler is like here, right? So I have a couple presets which I can select, and then I have a couple ones that are grayed out. It's going to skip those. So I press B, goes right to the next usable preset. Press A, goes back up. So yeah, if this was useful to you, don't forget to like and subscribe, tell a friend about it. And if there's any more questions you have, just leave me a comment. I'll be happy to help. And that being said, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video 1 week from now. Take care.